Here to chair this session on biomechanics and weight in the program. Three speakers. We ask the speakers to keep on time. So I want to leave 25 minutes for talk, so we have 5 minutes for questions. So something like 1 minute before 25 minutes, I will stand up and you know what it means.
Okay.
The first speaker is Sébastien Laporte from the Institut de Biomechanics, de Biomechanique Humaine.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk about rupture behavior. So I will change the length of the time. So we're more in the rupture. So what I want to do, in fact, is try to have a model of this in order to understand exactly how we have the rupture. So you know that there is already some finite element model, but for this kind of model, you can only try to have an idea of the maximal stress and the place of rupture in this kind of model. So when I spoke about dynamic, so we can say that there is three kind of regime: the quasi-static ones. Well, I think that everyone know what it is. So this, so I gave an idea of the strain rates for this. The intermediate strain, so something like this, so it's very useful, for example, for cash crash analysis. And the dynamic with very high strain rate for very huge car crash or plane crash if you are testing in plane. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes. So the idea of this is, in fact, that this one is very easy to obtain by a very simple system. It's only like this.
100 hertz.
It's only a point of view, I think, because if we look, it depends exactly on the materials or on the application, in fact. So for the bone, we are in this kind. For metals, it could be more high, so 100, and for this limit. But it's, I think, very something loose, and also designed by the materials that you are going to study. Also, if we take a look to the literature on mechanical behavior of spongy bones, so you have a lot of paper there. There is a lot of paper on quasi-statics, not at all in the intermediate, and not a lot in dynamics. So it could be an animal model or human model. And also, there is no crossover study, so you have the same material that will be tested along all the regimes. So I don't know if everyone know what is this split Hopkinson bar. So I just make a little explanation. So the idea is to have a striker, an input bar. There you have the sample, an output bar. The striker will impact the input bar, and you will create a wave in the input bar. When the wave is on the sample, a part of the wave will be go back in the input bar, and the other is transferred in the output bar. And then you have an incident wave, a reflected one, and then transmitted. The sample could be less than 1 centimeter. Yes, very, very little. And the length of the bar is really important, because the longest bar you have, the most time you can analyze the results. Because if we look to this, we have a lot of reflective tests, and at the end you have a destructive test. So this is something that was made at LMT Cachan. You have there some spongy bone, so you have a completely destructive test. So what you obtain in this case of test is this kind of stress-strain curve. So with a linear elastic, so this is linear elastic, we are not sure. You have a decrease of the nominal stress, could be explained by trabeculary ruptures. Then you have the pore closures, and then you have compaction, densification. And if you look to the so you can define some different elements. So an apparent yield modulus. You can have also a yield stress, an ultimate stress, a plateau stress, and you can also define some strain, so the yield strain and the ultimate strain. So in the real life, you obtain this kind of curve. So this is for quasi-static. There, this is for dynamic, and this is was for confined dynamic test. So you find the linear part, the maxima, the plateau, and these are the part of the curve that you can't analyze because they are due to the several reflection. So what we also find a lot in the literature is that a lot of people try to find links between the mechanical properties and architectural properties of the bone. This was a lot studied in quasi-static, but there is nothing in intermediate or dynamic test. So it was this is. So I think that everyone know this kind of parameters and make all the. So when you want to analyze the spongy bone, you have some geometrical or morphological parameters. So the one was most used is the BVTV, so the bone volume or the total volume. You can find something like mean thickness, trabecular separation, porosity. You find also connectivity, so the number of temporal points, the number of branch for and the mean number of branch, number of junction. So there is a lot of parameters, and you will find also parameters of anisotropy. So if you look to the literature, we can find a lot of parameters because a lot of people want to try to define something. And the idea at the end is to be able to obtain something like this, for example, the ultimate stress versus the trabecular thickness, and have a model of this. So you can find a lot of paper about this. But it's quite on the quasi-static analysis. So the idea was for us to try to do the same analysis for a large range of strain rates. And we first work on the cancellous bone specimen on bovine, so the bovines from South Africa, because we made the test in Captain. So we use a femoral head sample, grit control tear, with different plane, in order to build this kind of test, so what we call quasi-static test, so 10 power minus 3 to 10 power minus 1, the intermediate one from 1 to 100, and the dynamic from 400 to 600. What we do is that these tests were made with a very classical compression machine. So what is really interesting in the compression machine is that you can choose to stop the test before the end. Okay, you can choose this. We use a modified system of split Hopkinson bar, for this one, and another system developed by our colleague in South Africa for this one. So this is a wedge bar apparatus, so it's quite the same. You have a striker, you have a bar with a slope. There you have a system for the measurement, the bone, and the output bar. The striker then impacts this bar. The bar will be put in movement. With the slope, you will create the translation of this part, and then you have the compression. And in order to have a test that is not completely destructible, you can put this bar on this bar. When you have the impact of the wedge bar on the output bar, this bar will stop, and then you can stop the test at a chosen strain. So you obtain something like this. So you have the bone, you see the wedge bar there, the compression, and then you will see there the end of the test with the rupture. There. The interest of this is that we have a very interesting control rate conditions at constant. So the other setup is the SHPV. We use a conical striker, which is used for to obtain a very a good stability in the strain rate, and a momentum trap. And this momentum trap is used to stop the test before the complete rupture. So, just in order to explain this, you have the conical striker with the impact. So the impact will create a wave in this bar, but also in this cylinder. During the displacement of the wave in this, you have also the displacement of the wave in the second cylinder. The other will be exactly the same for the impact. And the idea is that when the wave come back from the sample, this will be captured by this cylinder. So you will have something like this. And then, as the bar will not come back, the sample will be full. So you can have this kind of test. With an impact with high velocity, but you can stop the test. In order to analyze the mechanical parameters, we obtain for each test this kind of curve. So we use what we call the 5 parameters logistic curve, like this, with some values. So the initial stress, final stress, something that define the slope, initial slope, a final slope, and also everything is a function of a nominal strain. So the parameters are this one. So this is the inflection point. We use an optimized robust nonlinear least square method to reduce the influence of the noise. We'll see why. In order to evaluate also the errors that we made on the identification of parameters, we use a bootstrap method. And we define the apparent Young modulus as the slope at the inflection point on the curve. So we have the formula like this. So we obtain so this kind of result. So you have there the strain, nominal strain, nominal stress. So it's also difficult to define exactly where is the beginning of the test. So when you place the model, you obtain this kind of good, we'll say, very good fitting. So we can define all the points. So what we can look, for example, so you have there the apparent Young modulus, and the error on the apparent Young modulus is above 2%. So this is for the quasi-static. Sorry. This is for the quasi-static, so you obtain this kind of curve. For the intermediate, so we have some noise for some curves, so I just choose the worst curve we have, so in order to see that the robust fitting is quite good. And you have exactly the same for the dynamic. So for the results, so you have there the strain rates, there the apparent Young modulus, and there the apparent the ultimate stress for all the tests. And if we look to the literature, so you have, so to explain, it's quite simple. So this is the reference. There you have the mean value of the reference. So we have quite a good agreement in the, I will say, in the quasi-static and the beginning of intermediate, but we have some difference with the dynamic part. So the difference is that this is not exactly the same species. So we were on bone, and this was on sheep or on human bone. Yes.
What impressed me is that forget about the comparison with big bone plants, the green. The error bar is as large as the.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. So you can say that, well, that band in this difference or whatever happening is between zero, you measure, say the average is one, is between zero and two, which is a piece of information anyway.
So this is really the result. So this. We measure such a variation, and this is also due to the specimen. So we see that we have good a link between the microarchitecture and the results. In fact, we choose some specimen with very low BVTV and other with high BVTV. So in fact, I think that this is not the truth, because you have an apparentian modulus which is depend of the materials and the microarchitecture. So it means also that if you say that spongy bone is a material, it's not really true.
Excuse me, how many samples?
Yes, at least there is 10, 20, 20, 20, 20, 20, 10.
Do you have any idea or at least a guess about the fact? Imagine that you were able to collect 100 specimens, or say 1,000.
That will be the...
Yes, exactly.
It's not. We made a lot of tests before in order to verify that it's not due to test, but not it's only due, let's say, to the specimen. So so I can give you this. So you have a strain sensitivity. So with the velocity, so it's not so really interesting, and you have so very statistical difference, and you can say that you have an increase about 4 kilopascal per decade during the test. But as you say, it's not so. This I will say the Ruth results. What is really interesting is to now try to compare these results with the microarchitecture. So to do this, we made some micro CT before and after. So you have this, and we compute some parameters, and there is a lot of parameters, and we try to find the correlations. So let's say. So you have, I will only give you the correlation for the intimate stress, but this is quite the same for the apparentian modulus. So for the quasi-statics, we find a good link with the BVTV, so bone volume over total volume, all the parameters in terms of geometry, all the connectivity, and also the anisotropy, so the anisotropy of the bone. So this is quite similar to the literature, and it was also the fixed point for us in order to see if we made the good choice and a good job. Now you have, so if you want to see there, you have there the BVTV of the bone sample from the quasi-static test. There you have the ultimate stress, so you have the points, so this is the linear link between the two. You have there the same for the intermediate parameter, so you see that there is something there. So we are not able to explain exactly this. And for the dynamic, you have exactly the same idea with, I will say, just a change of slope somewhere. So just to remember, we keep in fact the marrow in the spongy bone. So we have an effect of the marrow. So we have made some tests in quasi-statics for dryad test. We obtain some exactly the same the same data, and we have also some tests for the intermediate and dynamic, and the values and the correlations are still there. When we make confined tests, we put only something around the specimen in order that the marrow can't go outside. In this case, we have very different behavior between quasi-static, intermediate, and also dynamic. What we have made also is we have made the micro-CT with just post-compression. So we can have a 3D reconstruction of the specimen before and after the test. Then we can try to make the registration between the two. Yes, yes. So you will have this kind of registration. And so for some specimens we not be able to do this, but for 80% we have the this. And then we can compute, so we make a very simple thing, we compute the distance between the two registrations. So you have something there, when this is blue, the distance is quite equal to zero. When this is red, this is the highest distance. So using this, we find four different, three different rupture facies. So facies with no rupture, in fact. So the test was up to 6%. So you have a test, and then it was only elasticity for us. The other half, you have a face that is completely, has some trabeculae that are crushed, and 10 specimens with a rupture in, we'll say in shear, more in shear, in this case. So we can also see there, but the quality is not so bad. So if we just look at the link between the rupture facies and the point on the curve, let's take a look to this. So you have the model in blue, and you have also the experimental data that are on the dashed line. So the end of the test is there for this one. So we are not on the upper part, in fact, of the curve. So there is some little problem, but not a lot of data. If we go further on the curve, so for example, for this one, we have experimentally, we go at the ultimate stress and start to go down. So there is more deformation at the face, and it's quite evident. If we are at the end in this part, so we can have more damage in this. And very far from the, so for this one, if we are very far from the ultimate strain, we see that all this face has been crushed. So just this one was for quasi-static and this one for dynamic. So it could be also a velocity effect during this things. So the next idea is, okay, we make some experimental tests, we have fine links, okay, but we want to model this. And we want to model this in a simple way. So we first say that, in fact, if we want to go more in the analysis of the influence of the microarchitecture on the mechanical behavior, it could be cool to build a skeleton of skeleton-like of a cancellous bone. The idea to create like this. So we had the idea to say, for example, I can choose a set of parameters. So I would choose this one because it was the most important for us. And we are going to try to create a skeleton that has these properties. So we made this very simple. We create a number of nodes in the sphere. Then we create all the trabeculae. Then we have an optimization in order to delete the trabeculae that are not interesting for us. So we have for example, we try to obtain a good distribution of the trabecular length, also the good distribution of the point strips, so with three trabecular, four, five, and this, and also to be sure to obtain the good anisotropy. In this sphere, we can then cut a cylinder, and we just use the modified anisotropy formulation in order to manage the three direction of anisotropy. Then we can add a model, very simple model for each tabaculae. And as we put some fuzzy logic in this, we can, with the same parameters, obtain an infinite number of model. The next step is then, so from this skeleton or from the skeleton that we can build from the 3D reconstruction, we make some discrete element simulation. So from the skeleton, for very, very first approach, the nodes are balls and the beam are straight, the tabecula are straight beam. We impose some material properties, so this is in order to function, to be okay with the test, which is not the real value because we make some hypothesis, and then we can make the simulation of the impact. So let's say you will obtain this. So there you have the skeleton, and we will see the stress. In this one, the broken beam will be in black, and then you have there the stress-strain curve. So we have the compression test. So we are in the inner part. We have already some beam that broke, and then we obtain the ultimate strain, and we have a rupture in this. So we obtain something quite that has the same idea of as this. So we are always working on this part. So thank you for your attention. I can answer two questions.
Thank you. We have time for a few questions.
The fact that damage occurs on one side of the specimen, not throughout the volume, is it due to the inertial effect?
Yes. We obtain exactly this only for the dynamic test. In fact, we think that it's really inertia, only inertia.
In your result where you show you the beginning of the SU, did you look at SU max and with the strain rate, you can...
Let's say...
You had two big bumps.
Yes.
So one was at low strain rate, the other one was middle range strain rate. Do you think it has a link with physiological load? No, this one.
The previous one?
No, it was before. Yeah, that one. Yeah. You had a big bump and you had a small blue bump before.
There?
Yeah, the second one, and then 5 and 6. So do you think those strain rates correspond to something
different? We think so. Yes, and we have also some new results with our cooling in South Africa, for example. It seems to be something like this, constant up to 1, constant upper something between 1 and 10, so you have something like this as a behavior. So with something, I don't know exactly, to a K value where there is a change between the two. But for the ultimate strain, it's more linear from this.
And physiologically,
what is the risk
feedback
happening? So for this, for good question. So I will say that yes. Well, for me, we didn't try to find an answer to this. Okay. Yeah. Yes. We're not working on this value for the moment. We try to obtain more correlation, and we make the more the analysis. But for me, this is very. When we look through the analysis of the results in terms of statistics, we have really seen a change there, of groups there, and we say that it will be defined the quasi-statics for bone and the dynamic for bones. So in order to say something on this, but in terms of physiology, why, I don't know for the moment. So no, these are bovine bones. Yes. So, but for the other species, it's quite the same. So now the idea is to do this on human.
Do you think it corresponds to the cycle of loading?
We say, why not? Good idea.
And for instance, walking.
You say I will more speak in terms of frequency for walking. So this is not linked to a frequency. This is linked to a velocity of stress.
Yes. Yeah.
And if we look to the first idea, we said that in fact, if you look to this, when you run, you have strain rate really lesser than 0.1 in. So this is a very, very low. So this is not linked to the activity. Thank you.
It's a very short one.
Just if you have done these experiments in not in really in a homogeneous spot.
Yes.
And you see the same behavior in terms of increasing
for the
stiffness, or it is
so for the bar.
Yeah, like we see that the Young modulus increase.
Yes. Yes, it's what you find for any materials, in fact.
Yeah, but okay. If the material is really homogeneous, like tungsten.
Yes, on this kind of materials, you obtain an increase of the apparent Young modulus. Exactly the same, and also an increase of the ultimate stress. That's it's more like this.